and sprinkled him on the blades of the sacred grass, within brackets, the sun's rays. Thus the devas performed the sacrifice with the Purusha. The sadhyas, within brackets, the potential devas, you can say. It is unmanifest. That the potential devas and the seers also performed it. Here it is described that the fellow is spread on the sacred grass as the offering. That means the presence of the Purusha is sprinkled through what we call the sun's rays in all directions to make the creation possible. That's why it is described that he is burnt or cooked and sprinkled upon the sacred grass. That is, through the rays of the sun, the Lord comes down as creation. That's what they mean. And the devas work out the creation, therefore they have sprinkled him. And they found him always the firstborn. That means when they woke up, they found him already there every time. Whenever these devas woke up into existence, they find him already there existing before they came out. Suppose by the time you sleep in the night, you find Rudolph still working. By the time the next morning you wake up, you find him already working. Like that, they found the Purusha already existing before they existed. Whenever they began to exist, they found him there. Therefore, they made a sacrifice out of him. Whenever they came out, they worked out the creation and they made the creation possible. They brought it out. So he is always the firstborn. When we wake up, we find that life is always going on. The respiration is going on even while we are sleeping. Like that. They found him always the firstborn. That means, before a living being is born, he should be there. Then only he is there as the life, respiration, pulsation, etc. And then we find ourselves existing. Or conversely, when we find ourselves existing, we find the respiration already existing before we find it. Like that. So always the Purusha is the background. Whenever there was a group of devas, they found him already existing. So they had to work only with him. And they worked him as they offering or work or sacrifice. That is what they mean here. And therefore they made the sacrifice with him, from him, and out of him. If they want to bring out something, they have to bring out from him, because he is the background. Because in the next verse he is going to describe how they brought the various items of creation from him. In the next verse he is going to give us. That's why here, as an introduction, he says, out of him they brought everything. From him they offered him a sacrifice and they brought everything out of him. That means they made him the base of creation, because he was the base even to themselves. Even to their existence, he was the base. So they made him as the base of this creation, and then they brought everything of this creation out of him. So there are the devas who are potential devas, devas of manifestation and rishis. Rishis means sages. Here the various stages of devas are given. Devas exist as potential devas and manifest devas, and they exist as pure devas and seers. That is, these fellows preside over the intelligences of the creation. For example, the buddhic and the mental and the sensory and sensorial planes. The buddhic plane, the mental plane, the plane of senses. They are presided over by the devas, that group of devas called the rishis. Because the mind and the senses, they see. These devas are called the seers or the sages. They are also called the sages. It is because of them we are able to question something and receive the answer. We are able to write books and read books and understand. We receive so many sciences and arts through our mind because of these fellows called rishis working in our mind. They are the instructors. They are called the instructors in the scriptures. Yes. Unless they are there, we have nothing to study or read or understand. They are the lords of intelligences. So they have worked out. The two types of devas worked out, and the third, the rishis, also worked out. Of course, there are another type also, which are not required now. They are called the pitrus, who preside over some functions of creation. For example, the devas, the rishis preside over the functions of the various portions above the neck, because the brain, cerebrospinal nervous system, the senses and the cortical tissues are presided over by the rishis. And then the respiratory and the circulatory, the vital functions are conducted by the devas, and the reproductive functions are conducted by the pitrus. This is how the division goes in the scriptures. For example, the production of the reproduction tissues and the glands and the instincts of the sex, the attraction and the age and the functions of the various ages of the beings, they are presided over the or by the pitrus, and they are said to travel from the sun through moon to the earth. That is how the pitrus travel. For this reason, the moon goes round the earth once in 28 days and presides over the menstrual cycles that conduct the function of reproduction. That is called the calendar of the pitrus. Now you have to read the secret doctrine, about 300 pages explanation about these fellows, because there was much misunderstanding among the occidents about the pitrus when the Britishers made their inefficient translations of the scriptures. Especially Professor Max Müller and his followers, they have spoiled the whole thing and they have produced a mess of it. That's why Blavatsky gave a tough fight in the secret doctrine. He criticizes Max Müller and his followers many times. He says, Grimm's law is no philosophy. You can't teach philology and say that you are teaching scriptures. You shut up, she said. Because he has explained in his own way all dirty things. here she had to fight out and bring the original things once again. Now, this is called the calendar of the Pitras. You know the functions of fertilization and the growth of the embryo, the fetus, are conducted by the moon phases and the lunations. That's why it is described that the Pitrus come to earth via moon. And there is another planet who sends the Pitrus to the beings of the earth via the moon. That planet is not yet manifest on this earth. That's what the secret doctrine tells us. There are many things here to be explained about Pitrus. Therefore, just we make a mention of the Pitrus, the Rishis and the Devas. They are of two types, Sadhyas and Siddhas. So they made the ritual, that is the sacrifice, possible. Yes, that, and if we tamper with the natural functions, they begin to diverge from the normal condition. Suppose we don't allow the natural functions take their own natural course. Suppose there is a fine lady who uses the pills to postpone or prepone menses, then the devas are forced to go back. So only if the human beings are pleased to allow the devas to work, they are ready to work. Whereas in the animals, there is no such question. The devas work and they don't allow the animals to transgress. So this is only a description of how they made the sacrifice ritual. There is nothing very important in this stanza. We can go to the ninth stanza, which describes how the devas brought the various aspects from the yajna. Tasmat yajna sarvahutah samhratam prushadajyam pashu tan chakre vayavyan aranyan gramyan cha ye. Tasmat yajna sarvahutah samhratam prushadajyam pashun tan chakre vayavyan aranyan gramyan cha ye. Tasmat, from him, from that yajnat means sacrifice. Sarvahutah, all offered. Samhratam, the next word. Samhratam means gathered. And the word prasharajyam means charand ghee. The word pashun, animals. The word tan means those. Chakre, they have done. They, sorry, we have done. Chakre, vayavyan, the beings of air. Aranyan, the beings of the forest. Next, gramyan, the beings of the inhabited villages. Cha, also. Ye, those that were. That is a relative pronoun. Pardon? Prushad. Prushadajyam. Charand. This is charand. Now, the translation of the verse. From that all offering sacrifice, they gathered the charand ghee again, which they sprinkled the beasts, a full stop, the beasts, the birds, and the animals in the forest and in the village were made out of it. Here, you should separately add two more meanings, esoteric meanings for the word Aranya. Aranya means those that were born out of Arani. Arani means the fire churner, fire churning instrument. They have an instrument with which they take out the fire. That's called Arani. So these fellows produced the beings from that Arani also. And then Gramya also has an esoteric meaning. Gramya means group souls. Grama means a group. And afterwards it came to be called a village. The word village, the meaning village is a derivative meaning of the word group. First, grama, the word grama was used as a group of souls. And later it was used for the village. Because it was a group of families, a village, a commune, like that. And here, from that sacrifice, it is described here that these fellows have brought many things, the devas. From that sacrifice, they have churned the fire and brought the fuel of fire together. And they gathered the butter and then they sprinkled it. That is how it is described here. They gathered the butter and then they sprinkled it. That means it is a simile. The butter is the essence of the body of the animal which is fit to be food. That is what they have done in this creation. It is the essence of the animal which can be used as food. So from this fellow they have squeezed out the essence which should be used as food for the further beings. That means they used the body of one living being as the food of another body. That is how they produced. Devas decided that one fellow should eat another fellow. That is, the plants should eat from the minerals. The animals should eat from the plants. The man should eat from the plants, animals, minerals, etc., and something else. The human being eats from the animals, from the plants, from the minerals, and if there is something else also, we are ready to eat. So, they have made bodies as the food of some other beings. The body of one being is made food for the other being. That is what is described here. These devas, they have prepared it like that. They have gathered the essence of the Purusha as ghee, that is butter, and then they sprinkled it again. And from that act of sprinkling, they got the various beasts existing. For example, if there is a tiger existing, how does it exist? By eating the bodies of other animals. So they brought these pashus, that is the various animals, and then vayavyan, those that exist in the air, that is the birds, etc., the insects and the birds that live on wings, they produced. And some beings eat the birds, and then aranyan, those that exist in the forests, and gramyan, those that exist in the villages and eat what the humans give. Like this, the devas produced bodies as food for bodies. See, wonderful fellows. And here, Vayavyan means those beings that exist in air. That means the elementals of air. Not only birds. Unless the elementals of air help the birds to fly, they cannot fly in air. Why can't we fly in air? Because the elementals of air do not permit us to do it. Yes. Because we are more important than the birds, still we can't fly. Unless there is the aeroplane or something like that. Even then it is risky, not so natural as the birds do. And Aranyan means those that are born through fire churning. That means those that have the male and female separation and copulation and bringing forth children. That is called Aranyas. That is through the formula of the Arani, that is fire churner. That's the reason why the male and female bodies are produced, why there is the sex act and reproduction. That is what they mean by esoteric meaning of the word Arani. And then Gramya, group souls. That is, first, the whole earth was made as one soul. And then on this earth, there were only three or four living beings, each giving birth to a separate group of living beings. The fundamental living beings, who are three or four only, they are called group souls. For example, the first human being was produced on this earth, whose dimensions were many thousands of miles, because he had no physical body. There was only the human principle. Like that, the animal principle, the plant principle, the mineral principle. And then each was subdivided into many minerals, many plants and many atoms, and many human beings. Then there was the giant races of human beings. Then gradually, the separation of souls multiplied, and there is the pygmy human beings by the end of the 20th century. It is, dimensions came down because we are distributed into many souls. That's the reason why the number is too much multiplied. The number of human beings is too much multiplied during the 19th and 20th centuries on this earth globe. There is a big sensation. How the increasing numbers exist on this earth. Like that. So, they start with group souls. That is, there was only one man. He became two. One man and one woman. And they lived as companions. They gave birth to a few fellows. Story of Adam and Eve. And then there was the subdivisions. Then there was the necessity of the physical bodies. For some thousands of years, the human beings existed without physical bodies. Then only God gave them the coats of skin. In the Holy Bible, in the first chapter, you see that God gave him the coats of skin. That means the human fellows fell into matter and generation. Unless this meaning was there, Madame Blavatsky says, the Orthodox Christian bishop asks us to believe that the God is a celestial tailor. That's what she says. Because God could tag the skins and make robes of skin and give to human beings. That is how the Christian bishop wants us to believe. She says, he makes the celestial tailor of the first cause. That's how she describes in the secret doctrine. But coats of skin means physical bodies, matter. Then the group souls became individual souls. And then they became personalities. And then they became individualities. That is how the creation was made. So at first, they gathered the Purusha and they made sacrifice out of him. And they produced seven layers and three times seven sticks of fuel as the units of his creation, and then they made individuals out of the cosmic principles. You saw how the five states of matter and the five potentialities and the five senses and the five grass organs were produced, how the fellow Purusha was made into individuals. It was done through air and the elements of air, elementals of air, and through copulation, the sex acts, and through the division of the sexes, and the group souls became the individual souls. That is how the whole thing came to existence. In this stanza, what they have given us is, from Purusha there are devas, rishis and sadhyas. They made the sacrifice with Purusha. They made 7 into 3 sticks of fuel, that is the cosmic, solar and planetary principles, and they have burnt him on the rays of sun and sprinkled through the rays of sun, and then they produced as the elementals of air, fire, water and earth, and then they produced the fire churning process on the physical plane, that is the differentiation of sex and fertilization and childbearing. Through that process, they brought the group souls into individual souls. That is how this stanza and the previous stanza describe. Yes, the word Purusha indicates churning and also sprinkling. Yes, it has two meanings. One beast, that means he has prepared the bodies from the bodies of the Purusha to serve as the food of the beings. There's no other goal. But one thing, individual souls exist and individual mind exists only on this earth. On the other planets, they exist, but there is no individual mind. Beings exist as lights, and they have sensations and consciousnesses as lights, but no individual mind. Individual mind is possible only on this earth planet, in every solar system. Yes, in the 12 solar systems. Yes, and a group of 12 solar systems exists, and the millions and millions of solar systems exist in groups of 12, as the esoteric astrology says. And out of each group of 12, there are 7 sacred suns and 5 non-sacred suns. All those things can be supplemented here. Yes, every sun has his own family, solar system, just as every fellow has his own wife and children. Here, another point also is just mentioned. The devas made 3 into 7 sticks of the same Purusha. In some other hymns of Rig Veda, there is an information which is to be supplemented. They took 3 into 7 sticks from the same Purusha, yet the Purusha stands there, and they divide it into the 7 planes. There is a number which is less than 1 and more than 0. That's the number of the Purusha. It is less than 1 and more than 0. It is said that all the numbers 1 to 9 exist in it simultaneously. It was called by the ancients the number of simultaneity, or the positive zero, about which I discussed something in my spiritual astrology on the chapter of Aquarius. we can understand that number only in the near future, when the Aquarian age really begins to dawn on the human mind. Before that, that number is not known by the mathematicians also. We know only one zero now, whereas there are two types of zeros according to the ancient mathematics. We see there is the positive zero and the negative zero also. And here it is, he is described as the positive zero in some of the hymns of Rig Veda. And what we try to understand as pi is given in the Vedic texts like this. Here